Hey there, Spark fans. Rob and Drew here once again to talk more about the XRP. Now, in the last video, we learned how to control the motors, how to drive our bot around, how to make shapes. And this time, we're going to take a look at the remaining parts of this kit that are the sensors and the servo, and we're going to do a delivery challenge using those.
Yep, that's right. So you can see here on the table, we have this line made of black tape that the robot is going to use the reflectance sensor on the bottom to follow that line all the way to the end, where it's then going to use the ultrasonic sensor at the front to detect a package of very important stuff we have here. It's then going to turn around and pick up the package using the arm, then follow the line all the way back to Rob and deliver the package.
All right, so let's take a look and see how we made that happen.
Now, as we always do, open a browser and go to xrpcode.wpi.edu, then connect your robot with the USB cable. Now, just like the last video, we're going to create a new Blockly file for us to write our code in, but you can also use MicroPython if you prefer. And we will also periodically show the Python equivalents for those who want to see the syntax. Before moving on, I'm going to save this file to the XRP, and after we do this, it will autosave every time we run the code. Because our goal here is to do a delivery challenge, I'm going to title it delivery underscore challenge, and click OK to save it to the XRP. Now on the left panel, under the servos section, grab the servo block from here. Within this, you can choose which servo to use, and because the servo is plugged into port 1, I will leave it as 1. And then we can also choose what angle to move the servo to. To demonstrate the motion of the servo, I'm actually going to have 3 of these servo blocks. So if you just right-click, then click Duplicate, it will create a new instance of each block. Something to note is that the servo block will not actually wait for the servo to finish moving, so we're going to add some delay to make sure it's done moving. On the left, under the logic, grab the sleep block. Now I'm going to attach this to that first servo block and change the time to 1 second. Then I will attach the next servo block, duplicate the sleep block, and attach the last servo block. And here I'm going to change these angles to 0 degrees, 90 degrees, and 180 degrees. That's it for the first demo. We will quickly show the Python equivalent for those who want to see that. And then we will click the run button in the top right corner to run this code. At this point, make sure you have batteries installed in your robot, and also flip the power switch on the XRP if you get this message. Then we can click OK, and the robot will run the code after a moment. Now when you hit the run button, make sure you keep your hands clear because the servo is going to move. If you notice that the range of the servo isn't quite correct, then you can always pull off the servo arm and reinsert it into the correct position. Also note that the servo will continue holding position even after the code stops, so if you want to be able to move it by hand, you'll need to turn off the power switch. Now that we know how to control the servo, let's pick up a package. You'll need a package of some kind that has something for the arm on the servo to grab, something with a loop or a hook on it. Here I have a small SparkFun box with a hole that I cut out at the center that is just the right height for the servo when it is straight back. The robot can drive backwards and then rotate the servo to pick up the box.
That's good, incorporating motor control like we learned in the last video and adding it on.
Exactly. Back on the computer, let's update the code to do what I just described. We'll want the robot to first drive backwards, so under the drivetrain blocks, we can grab the straight block that we used in the previous video. Now I'm going to insert this after the second sleep block so that the servo has time to go back to that 0 degrees, which we saw is straight backwards. Then instead of driving forwards at 20 centimeters, I actually want to go at -5 centimeters to go backwards. After this, I also want the robot to drive forwards, so I'm going to duplicate this block, insert it after that second sleep, and change it to be +5 centimeters. And then I can delete this last servo block. Now here, I found the best angle for this package is actually about 60 degrees, so I'll set it to that. And now we're ready to test. So we will quickly show the Python equivalent. And then we will click the run button to test this out. And again, make sure you have batteries installed and turn on the power switch. Then once you're ready, click OK. Now again, keep your hands clear because the servo is going to move and the robot is going to drive, and be prepared to grab it if it does run away. Here you can see the servo moves, drives backwards, and it picks it up just like we want it to.
Excellent. Well done.
Thank you. And then I will flip the power switch on the control board to disable the servo. Now all this code here, I actually want to keep for the final delivery challenge, so I'm going to temporarily disable it while we work on the next topic. Again, you can just right-click on the blocks and click Disable Block to prevent them from doing anything. Next, let's learn how to measure distance with the ultrasonic range sensor. On the left panel, under the sensors section, grab distance, the sonar distance block. And this will give the measured distance in centimeters. We can also display this using the print block that we used from last time. Under text, grab print, and attach that block onto there. Now this will only print one time, but I actually want to keep printing it, so I'm going to add a loop like we did in the last time. Under the loops, grab this repeat while block, and we need to set the condition for when this loop ends. And we'll do the same thing as last time, where we'll repeat until the user button is pressed. And last thing, this will function, but it's going to print out as fast as possible, which might be too fast. So under the logic, grab the sleep block, attach this here, and I will change this to 0.1 seconds, so it prints out 10 times per second. And that's all we need for this, and we'll quickly show the Python equivalent. And then we'll click the run button to see what this does. Now, because we're just using the sensor, we can actually leave the power switch in the off position if you want to. And I'll click OK, and we'll see what happens. So now you can see we're getting values printed at the bottom, and it's currently measuring the distance to a wall I have off to the side. But if we place an object in front of it, you can see the measured distance changes. And notably, when the package is right in front of the robot, we're getting around 15 centimeters right here, which is what I'm going to use for my delivery challenge. And then once we're done, you can press the user button to stop the code. Now that we know how to use the ultrasonic range sensor, next thing I want to do is have the robot drive forwards until that range sensor gets within some threshold, and then we'll have the robot stop in place. Now let's update the code to do that. I'm actually going to use this while loop, but I want to keep a copy of it for later. So I'll go ahead and duplicate this, and then disable that off to the side. Now my plan here is I'm going to modify this so that in the loop, it will try and drive towards the object until that range sensor is below some threshold. The way we can do that is under the logic section, grab this comparison block. There are several comparisons we can do. We can have equals, not equals, less than or equal, greater than, or greater than or equal. In this case, I'm going to change it to less than. And then on the left side, I'm going to steal this sonar distance block and stick it in there. And then I want a number on the right side, so I'll go to the math, grab the number block, and I'm going to change this to 15. Now instead of repeating until the user button is pressed, we will instead repeat until that sonar distance is less than 15 centimeters. Then I'm also going to remove the print and the sleep from inside the loop, and I will instead grab the drivetrain block. And I'm actually going to use the arcade block here, which is going to be useful in a little bit. What this does is it allows you to separately set the effort for forwards and turning rather than the left and right motors individually. And the reason I'm doing it this way is because that will be useful for the line following in a bit. In this case, for now, I'm just going to leave the straight effort as 0.5 and the turn effort as 0, because I want it to just drive straight forwards. Then once this loop is done, I want the motors to stop. So I'll go into the drivetrain, grab the stop motors block, and attach that to the end. The last thing I'll do is I don't want this code to start running until I press the user button. So we'll go under the control board, grab this wait for button press block, and attach it to the top there. And now this is all we need. We will show the Python equivalent. And then we can click the run button to test this. Again, make sure you have batteries installed and the power switch is on, and then click the OK button to start that code. And now the robot is currently waiting for us to press the user button, but before we do, just make sure that you've got a clear space, be prepared to grab the robot in case it runs away, and also make sure your USB cable is not going to get tangled in anything. So, I'll go ahead and press the button, and we'll see if this works. And there you can see, it stopped just before it hit the box. Now, the last thing we're going to look at on how to use is the reflectance sensor on the bottom. And you'll notice this is actually two different sensors in one board. What these do is they shine infrared light to the surface below it, and the amount of reflected light is measured by the sensor. In order to get the measurements from the reflectance sensor, under the sensor section, grab reflectance, and you'll notice there's two here. There is the left reflectance and the right reflectance. I'm going to do the same thing I did before, where I have this print loop to display these values. So I will go ahead and re-enable this and then disable the previous code. Now you'll notice the print block only takes a single item in it, but I actually want to print two different items. Fortunately, there is a block under the text section, this create text with block. So I'm going to replace the sonar distance and stick that in there, and then attach the left reflectance and the right reflectance. Now this will display both of those values right next to each other, but there's going to be zero space between them. So I want to add a bit of space here. Fortunately, this block allows you to configure it. If you click the blue gear icon, then you can click this item, drag it into the middle, and it adds a third spot for us to add something else in between them. What I will do is under the text, grab this text block, stick that in there, and then I'm going to add four spaces to really make sure that they're completely separated from each other. And now we're ready to test this. So I will go ahead and show the Python equivalent. And then we will run this to see what happens. So now you can see we're getting values printed from that sensor. And I currently have the robot over the white part of the table, not the black tape. And you can see the sensor values we're getting are around 0.5 or so. And as I bring the right sensor over the black tape, you can see the right sensor value now goes to a value of about 0.93. So there's a little bit increase there. And then as I move this across, you can see how those values change. And then you can press the user button to stop the code. If you notice that the sensor values are flipped, then you'll want to double check your wiring on the sensor. Now that we know how to use the reflectance sensor, let's write some code that makes the robot follow the line. What I will do is I'm going to re-enable my drive code from before. And I'm going to steal the left and right reflectance blocks and then delete my print loop because I don't need that anymore. Now think about what would happen if we were to subtract the right reflectance value from the left reflectance value. If we're on the right side of the line, the left sensor value will be bigger than the right one, so we'll get a positive number. When we're on the left side of the line, the opposite will be true, and we'll get a negative number. And regardless of which side of the line we're on, as we get further from the line, that difference is going to get further and further away from zero. Also important to note is in the arcade drive block, if we put a positive value for the turn effort, the robot will turn to the left because of the right-hand rule that we talked about last time. So let's put this together. If we take the left reflectance value minus the right reflectance value, that difference, if we put that into the turn block, then that should make the robot follow the line. In order to subtract two numbers, we can go under the math section and grab this arithmetic block. Now I will change it from addition to subtraction, and I will add the reflectance blocks in here like that. Now I could add this straight into the turn section of the arcade block, but what I'm actually going to do instead is I'm going to store this value into a variable. It's not strictly necessary for this, but it is a useful thing to know how to do. Under the left panel, under the variable section, click on create variable. And because this is going to be my turn effort, I will call it turn_effort. And then click OK to create that. Now we have these blocks here that allows us to change and get the value from that turn block. So I'm first going to set that in the start of the loop, and I will attach this subtraction block to it. And now that turn effort variable will be set to whatever the difference is between these two sensor values. Then in the variable section on the left, we can grab the turn effort block and stick that into the turn effort for the arcade section. Now let's test this and see what happens. We will show the Python code first, and we'll run this again. Now the robot is currently running the code, and the USB cable is going to get a little funky here, so I'll go ahead and just unplug that, and it will keep running that same code as long as you have batteries installed and the power switch is on. Then I will position the robot on top of the line with the reflectance sensor just over it. And also at the end of this track, I have the object that it's going to detect because it will stop once it reads that sonar distance. But just be prepared for it to run away, so grab the robot if you need to. So we'll push the user button, and you can see it is actually following the line. And you can even go around the corner. You notice there's a lot of wiggle to it. That's something that we're going to address in a moment, but the robot stops just like we want it to. Now let's see if we can fix that wiggling. The problem here is actually that the difference between the left and right reflectance values is too big, and that causes the turn effort to make it oscillate back and forth. And so we can scale that turn effort by some value to correct for this. So just after setting the turn effort, I'm going to grab one more of the set turn effort block. And then under the math section, I'm going to grab another one of these arithmetic blocks. And on the left side, I'm going to duplicate this turn effort. And instead of a plus, I will change this to a multiply. And I'm going to set this to 0.5. Now what this will do is it will decrease the turn effort by 50%. And in my testing, this actually makes the driving a lot better. Let's test it out to see what happens. First, we'll quickly show the Python code. And we'll run this again. And just like before, the robot is still running the code, so I'm going to unplug the USB cable and place the robot at the start of the line. Now let's see what happens when we press the user button. You can see it follows the line much more smoothly now, and there's no wiggling back and forth. And it still stops just like we want it to.
You see that little robot? Work smarter, not harder.
Now what we've done here is we've actually created something called a proportional feedback controller, where this value of 0.5 is what's called the proportional gain. Now we're not going to talk any more about feedback controllers in this video, but it is a useful topic to know about. Now we've learned everything that we need to do to the delivery challenge, let's talk about what exactly is involved in the delivery challenge. So currently we have this piece of 1-inch wide black tape on this white table, and we have our package at the end of that line. That's, you know, the position is marked out with a couple bits of tape there so we know where it is. The robot is going to start at the beginning of the line and use the reflectance sensor to follow it all the way along until the ultrasonic range sensor measures that it reaches the package. While you're driving, you'll also want to measure the encoder values to know how far you drove, because after the robot turns around and picks up the package with a servo, you'll then want to follow the line all the way back. And once you've driven the exact same distance that you did before, the robot turns around, drops off the package. So that's the challenge. Now we're not going to show any more code in this video, but you should have enough information from this video and the previous one to make it all work. In fact, we've already done the first part of making the robot follow the line to the package, and we even have the code over here that will pick up the package, but first the robot needs to turn around. So it's up to you to figure out how to do the rest of it.
That's excellent. And you know what? You've inspired me. I want to give it a try. I'll be right back. Hey, it works. I mean, maybe that wasn't as practical as your demonstration, but...
I was very entertained, Rob. I appreciate it.
Good, good.
So if you get done with this delivery challenge and are looking for a little bit more, another thing you can do is see if you can use the reflectance sensor to detect an intersection. And if you get that working, see if you can have the robot follow a maze.
Oh, nice. So that's everything in the kit. Yes, we've gone through everything.
Yep, that's everything. So that's the control board with the integrated IMU, the drive motors with built-in drive encoders, the ultrasonic range sensor, the reflectance sensor, and the servo.
Great. Now that you've gotten this far, this is not designed to just get here and be put on the shelf. This is not an endpoint. This is a starting point. It is designed for expansion.
Yep, absolutely. In fact, the rails that go around the perimeter of the robot are really designed for you to attach anything to. And you can always control it with connecting to various connectors on the control board. As a quick preview, one of the things I've done is I've attached some LEDs to the bottom of the robot as underglow.
Sweet.
We'll talk about that and more expansion possibilities next time.
Great. Until then, happy hacking.
Happy roboting. Now we've learned everything that we need to do. Yes, I should mention the motor control. I should mention how the robot's gonna drive. It's gonna do.
I see you're giving it the old Rob Reynolds start. Hi, Spark fans. I'm Line.